Most organic molecules don't have any color at all. An example of that would be ethene or ethylene. So ethene has two carbons, and each of those carbons is sp2 hybridized, so each of those carbons has a p orbital. So we have a total of two p orbitals, or two atomic orbitals, and those two atomic orbitals are going to recombine to form two molecular orbitals, so one bonding molecular orbital and one anti-bonding molecular orbital. The bonding molecular orbital has a lower energy, and so this represents the bonding molecular orbital down here. The anti-bonding molecular orbital is higher in energy, so this is the anti-bonding molecular orbital. Ethene has two pi electrons. Let me go ahead and highlight those two pi electrons in magenta here. And those two pi electrons go into the bonding molecular orbital, and so that orbital is occupied. We could also call this orbital the highest occupied molecular orbital, or the HOMO. And this would be the lowest unoccupied molecular orbital, or the LUMO. And there's a difference in energy between the HOMO and the LUMO. And that difference in energy is very important because that difference in energy corresponds to a wavelength of light. And so energy is equal to Planck's constant times the speed of light divided by the wavelength. And so energy and wavelength are inversely proportional to each other. And a certain amount of energy corresponds to a certain wavelength of light. And so this energy difference between the HOMO and the LUMO corresponds to a certain wavelength of light. And that wavelength of light turns out to be approximately 171 nanometers. And so when ethene absorbs light at a wavelength of 171 nanometers, that corresponds to the proper amount of energy between the HOMO and the LUMO. And that's enough energy for one of those pi electrons to jump from the HOMO to the LUMO in a pi to pi star transition. And so we talked a lot about pi to pi star transitions in the first video on UV vis spectroscopy, so make sure to watch that video before you watch this one. And so that's the idea of what's happening with ethene. It absorbs light at a wavelength of 171 nanometers. Let's move on to 1,3-butadiene, which has four carbons. Each one of those carbons is sp2 hybridized, and so each one of those carbons has a p orbital. So we have four p orbitals, four atomic orbitals, which would recombine to form four molecular orbitals, two bonding and two antibonding. So the two bonding molecular orbitals are lower in energy than the two antibonding molecular orbitals. And we have a total of four pi electrons for butadiene. So here's two pi electrons, and here's the other two. So four pi electrons. Those pi electrons occupy the two bonding molecular orbitals. Next, our job is to find the highest occupied molecular orbital, that's this one, and the lowest unoccupied molecular orbital, that's this one. And so the energy difference between the HOMO and the LUMO is what we're thinking about here. And notice that this energy difference, right, this difference in energy is smaller than the difference in energy in the previous example. And so if you think about the equation that relates energy and wavelength, if you decrease the energy, since they're inversely proportional to each other, you must increase the wavelength. And so we must have a higher wavelength than before. So instead of 171 nanometers, 1,3-butadiene is going to absorb light at approximately a wavelength of 217 nanometers. Finally, let's look at 1,3-5-hexatriene. So if I look at the pi electrons, we have 2, 4, and 6 pi electrons. Those 6 pi electrons fill the three bonding molecular orbitals. Next, we find the highest occupied molecular orbital and the lowest unoccupied molecular orbital, and look at the energy difference between them. Notice the energy difference has gotten even smaller. And if we, once again, decrease the energy, we increase the wavelength of light that's absorbed. So the wavelength of light must be even higher than this. And it goes up to approximately 258 nanometers. So hexatriene absorbs light at approximately 258 nanometers. That's still in the UV region of the electromagnetic spectrum. And so hexatriene doesn't have a color. In order for something to have a color, it has to absorb light in the visible region. And that is only accomplished by thinking about conjugation. So here we have hexatriene, which is conjugated, right? Double bond, single bond, double bond, single bond, double bond. But it's still absorbing light in the UV region. But imagine a molecule that has much more conjugation than hexatriene. increased conjugation means an increased wavelength of light that's absorbed. So notice our trend here, right? As we increase in the amount of conjugation, we increase the wavelength of light that's absorbed. And so if we have an extensively conjugated molecule, we could absorb light at an even higher wavelength. And if we get past approximately 400 nanometers, we're into the visible region. And those molecules should have color. And so that's the idea. Extensive conjugation leads to color. And let's look at beta-carotene, which is what we talked about in the previous video. And we said that beta-carotene is orange, right? So we have an orange molecule here. And once again, the key is conjugation. Look how conjugated beta-carotene is. Look at all the alternating single and double bonds. The extensive conjugation means that this molecule can absorb light at a longer wavelength, and it absorbs light in the visible region of the electromagnetic spectrum. And beta-carotene absorbs blue light and reflects orange, which is why we said carrots and the molecule looks orange here. So it's conjugation that you have to think about. Let's move on to one more example, phenolphthalein. All right, so phenolphthalein is probably the most famous acid-base indicator. So if you've taken a general chemistry lab, I'm sure you've used phenolphthalein as an indicator for your acid-base titrations. And so you know, at a low pH in an acidic environment, phenolphthalein is colorless. But if you add base, so here we'll talk about adding base here, right? So you increase the pH, you see a pink or magenta color. And let's see if we can explain why. So first, let's add some sodium hydroxide. So let me add some sodium hydroxide here. So there's a hydroxide anion, and I'm drawing in another hydroxide anion here. So a negative one charge on the oxygen. Hydroxide anion is going to function as a base. It's going to take this proton, which we could take these electrons and move them into here, which pushes these electrons over to here. These electrons move in here, and these electrons come off onto the oxygen. The other hydroxide would take this proton, and these electrons would end up on the oxygen here. So let's follow those electrons. Electrons in magenta move into here like that. Let's use blue for the next one here. So these electrons in blue move into here. And let's go for green. So these electrons in green move into here. And then finally, these electrons in red move off onto this oxygen. So we give that oxygen a negative one formal charge. And if this hydroxide anion takes this proton, then these electrons end up on this oxygen, I should say, giving that oxygen a negative one formal charge. And so we form an ion here. And this ion has a pink or magenta color to it. And if we look closely at it, we can see why. Look at the conjugation that's present. So there's all kinds of alternating single and double bonds, right? So double bond, single bond, double bond, single bond, double bond, single bond, double bond, single bond, double bond, and so on. So pretty much the entire ion is conjugated. So we have this extensive conjugation, which allows the ion to absorb in the visible region. And that's why it appears to be a pinkish color here. We could go back the other direction. Right, so if we add some acid, right, we could turn this back into the colorless form of phenolphthalein here. And the reason why this is colorless is because this carbon, let me go ahead and highlight this carbon right here. This carbon is sp3 hybridized, right? It's sp3 hybridized, therefore it doesn't have a p orbital. And so we have a little bit of conjugation in the benzene rings, right? So we have these alternating single and double bonds here. But this conjugation is disrupted when we get to this central carbon. And so we don't have conjugation throughout the entire molecule here. And so we don't have enough conjugation, and so it doesn't absorb in the visible spectrum, and that's why it appears to be colorless. If we look at that carbon over here on the right, so let's use red here. So this carbon right here, this carbon is sp2 hybridized, right? So it has a p orbital, which allows delocalization of these electrons. So we have extensive conjugation, and so we get the color. And so hopefully this just helps you understand how important conjugation is for color.